dead. He's risen. Listen.
No one can touch my heart like you, or make me smile the way you do.
Come on, talk to me in this house. Anybody need something brand new? Anybody want to start all over again? Come on, say amen. I love how the servant of the Lord says that the spirit-filled life results not only in personal victory over sin, but also in a fresh desire. Somebody shout fresh. And ability to share the Christian life and hope with others. This revival is all about giving us a fresh brand new start in Jesus Christ. Father, in the name of Jesus, bring revival tonight, and we'll give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
And we give God the glory tonight. We're on night two of our revival. Amen. Yes. Let's keep reviving your soul. Yeah. We're going to sing about how great God is tonight. I just want you to sing along and worship with us tonight as we give God praise for how great He is. Amen. You know this song. Put your hands together like this. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great. How great. is I sing with me how great is He's good and He's mighty. Everybody should see how great. A really great God. Come, let me hear you celebrate a really great God. Hallelujah. I invite you to stand on your feet tonight for our theme song. God, we have a call of revival this week, and that call has a sound. The call has a sound. And we learned this last night, and we just want you to worship with us as we ask God for the sound of revival to come in our hearts and touch us once again. I hear the sound.
I hear the sound of revival deep in the hearts of your people. Send it now.
Oh Lord, we want it.
Want it now.
Your glory,
release your glory, send your glory.
We're hungry,
we're thirsty for
only you, God.
We want
and we're patient. If you're waiting on God, I want you to say, God, I'm desperate for you tonight. And I, Lord, I'm desperate for you. Lord, we're waiting on you tonight. Lord, we're lost without you tonight. We need you more than ever before.
Good evening, everybody. I just want you to know that I'm Carol Wallington. I'm one of the elders here, and I came to Brinklow. I've been here about 30 years. And I've been the Sabbath school teacher here for about 20 years. And that has been through our elder at that time, Elder Bert Reed, who was an example to the rest of us. we're going to read this evening for our scripture, 2 Chronicles 12:7-12-16. 2 Chronicles 7:12-16. And the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said unto him, I have heard thy prayer, and I have chosen this place to myself for a house of sacrifice. If I shut up heaven that there be no rain, or if I command the locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Let's bow our heads. Oh, Heavenly Father, we come this evening praising your holy name, thanking you for your love. You love us so much that you have given us your Son, who died, rose again, and lived a righteous, a perfect life that we may have salvation. You have given us your word, Heavenly Father, the scriptures, and you say that if we would humble ourselves, if we would listen to what you are saying in your word, if we would repent, we would hear you. We would hear you from heaven. Oh, Lord, hear us tonight. Forgive us for our many sins. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness and baptize us with your Holy Spirit. Be with our speaker this evening. You have just what we need to hear. Please prepare our hearts and be with him as he speaks what you have given him to say. Thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
What a blessing it is to be here on night two of our 60th anniversary. And tonight, I know the day has been tedious. For some of you, it probably started before sunrise. Anybody get up before sunrise today? Hallelujah. God is going to bless you because you came by faith tonight. Whatever your hour is, and whatever you are in your journey, Kathleen and I have been at Brinklow now going on 12 years, and many of you have been here a whole lot longer, and even some of you less than that. But no matter where we fall in the 0 to 60, we're all a part of the family called Brinklow. Can you say amen? Do me a favor. Would you stand up and touch somebody you don't know tonight? Somebody you don't know, and just welcome them to another night of revival. Who don't you know tonight? Amen. Amen. We praise God for the get to know one another. Hallelujah. We give God the praise for your greeting and your smiles. Pastor, there are a lot of us that don't know one another. But to God be the glory, we're here tonight. Let me just share with you as we come back to our seats. Nothing like revival fellowship. Revival Fellowship. We're happy to have our former pastor, Pastor Gary Wimbush, here tonight, and he will be introduced. But on tomorrow night, Dr. Paul Anderson will be preaching the Word of God. And a guest artist, like tonight, we have a homegrown artist, Dewan Starling. We praise the Lord for Minister Starling. And on tomorrow night, Marette Brown Clark will be singing here with us and joining us as Dr. Paul Anderson preaches the word. We want to remind you that when you leave the lobby, there is a creative tree out in the lobby that has a video on it. You can hold your phones up and it will allow you to take your photos and put on the actual device there in the tree. And I tell you, our own Nicole is so gifted, so talented, so creative. I don't know what she can't do, but please add to the 60th anniversary by adding your photos. And we praise the Lord for that this evening. May the Lord bless us tonight as we worship Him in spirit and in truth.
At Emmanuel-Brinklow Seventh-day Adventist Church, we celebrate not just 60 years of faith and community, but also a long-standing tradition of sports and wellness. As part of our history, we have come together to make sure that we have programs that foster discipline and camaraderie among Brinklow family and are set to teach our youth about being part of a team. For years, Brinklow has been winning trophies in basketball from peewee, pony, and varsity basketball teams. We have also been able to tackle non-traditional sport events such as 5Ks and Spartan races with our Brinklow Strong team. Remember, we had the Outdoor Dojo by Dr. Anthony Medley. Integral to our mission is our commitment to health, with health clinics and educational talks like our Medical Minute by Dr. Cephas, Dr. Deshay, or Dr. Harry with insights on goji berries. We ensure our community's wellness is always a priority. Our sports and health programs are more than just activities. They are where bonds are formed, spirits are lifted, and bodies are strengthened. As we look to the future, we are excited to expand these programs, continuing to build a healthier, stronger community. We build family together.
We're going to lift our offering at this time. The deacons will begin from the back and come forward. Let's have a word of prayer before we begin. Heavenly Father, we thank you all the time for what you do for us. And we ask you to help us to be obedient and return to you all that you give, all the blessings that you give to us, that we will show that blessing in our offerings. Please bless each individual here and bless that which will be received. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. We continue to ask God to keep on blessing us. Come on, let's sing, "The Lord is blessing me right now, oh, right now." Come on, put your voices together. The Lord is blessing, me right now, right now. Right now.
He woke me up this morning. He woke me up this morning. I was cold in my right mind. Thank God he did it. He never makes it too late. But he woke me, woke me, woke me right on time. He woke me, woke me.
It is time for intercessory prayer. And what I would like to do is to share with all of you a family tradition that my grandparents started before we would ever leave each other's presence. George and Claudia Moses would have us stand around the altar that was in their home, and we would hold hands and we would pray. And so I just want to invite everyone to kind of gather in that center aisle, and let's kind of get together, let's hold hands, and let us pray on tonight. Thanks, man. I appreciate it. Yo, we got some. I'm gonna invite the sound to come join us in the prayer too. My mic works, so I see Kenny. You can come on. God, we thank you. We come before your presence right now. Many of us with so much to be grateful for. God, our children are in church. God, we thank you. God, our sons and daughters have done good in this first year at Oakwood. God, we thank you. They're finding their talents and their passions. Lord, we praise you. God, many of us have been coming to you for healing, and God, our bodies are whole. God, many of our marriages were struggling, and God, we are still together. God, many of us have been angry, and yet tonight we come into your house with joy. Many of us have been depressed, and yet, God, we come into your house with a praise on our lips. So, God, before we ask for another thing, we just want to take an opportunity to thank you for everything. Thank you for the breath in our lungs. Thank you, God, for the families in our homes, the food on our table, the clothes on our back, the money in our bank accounts. God, we have more than we could ever ask or think. And we thank you. But God, we come before your presence in the midst of a celebration of 60 years. And Lord, we pray and ask for reconciliation. God, we pray and ask for wholeness. We pray and ask, God, that we all come back home and come back together, because, Lord, you have a work that you're wanting to do in the next 60. So, God, bring us back into this place. May we be on one accord like Pastor has prayed. And may, God, your Holy Spirit descend upon us like tongues of fire, that we might be able to, God, be revived on tonight. Yes. Revive us again, God. not just, Lord, for form or fashion, not so that we could just be spiritual for the sake of being spiritual, but God, some people told me this week that this is a praying church, that this is a church that when you have need, you come and God, you move. And so God, we are asking that you not show us what you did in the last 60, but God, we're picking up new stones of faith on tonight, believing that you're going to do a new thing and that it's going to spring forth. And so God, perform miracles in this church because of our faith in you. We praise you. We thank you. We ask for a double portion of your Holy Spirit on Elder Wimbish tonight. God, you know that you have filled him in the past. We know that he has prayed. We know that he has prepared. But God, we ask for an unleashing of the Holy Spirit in ways you have not unleashed before, so that chains are broken, so that relationships with you are rekindled, and so that the vision is set forth with clarity on where you would have us to go. Revive us, God. Yes. This is our prayer. In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
One of the first quartet songs I ever sang was a little song that says, just a little talk with Jesus. Makes it right, all right. Albert, don't push me today. I once was lost in sin, and Jesus took me in, and then a little light from heaven. Oh my, oh Lord, and he wrote my name above, and just a little talk, well, now let us come on in, I know he'll hear. And he will answer by and by. Oh Lord, feel little prayer will turn it, and there's no little light is burning. You can have a little talk with Jesus, makes it right. Oh, have a little talk with Jesus, come on in. I know. Well, yeah, oh, yeah, come on, oh Lord, just a little talk with Jesus makes it right. Excuse me. This evening, we are honored and we are happy to have with us yet another of our beloved and former pastors here at the Emmanuel-Brinklow Seventh-day Adventist Church. He's the second son of the former Chris and Bernice Wimbish, who are both deceased of Loma Linda, California. He's the brother of Kenny and Donna Wimbish of San Bernardino, California. He is a product of both public and Christian education, where he graduated from Loma Linda Academy in the class of 1971. He matriculated at Oakwood College, now Oakwood University in Huntsville, Alabama, where he earned the Bachelor's of Arts in Theology in 1975. Additionally, he attended Andrews University, the Seventh-day Adventist Theological Seminary, where he earned the Master's of Divinity degree in 1977. He attended the Western State University College of Law and Howard University Theological Seminary in Fullerton, California and Washington, D.C., respectively. He is married to the infamous Dr. Cecilia Lester, both of Ellicott City, Maryland, who has a thriving pediatric and adolescent medicine practice in Tacoma Park and has had that practice for four decades. She is affectionately known as Dr. Cece throughout the community. They have three adult children, Kalea, Brennan, Chanel, and Kyle, Brittany, and six grandchildren, Braden, Christopher, Cara, Kendall, Brendan, and Imani. Come on, his quiver is full. He has served the church in various capacities as a pastor, university administrator, professor, law school dean. Can I say that again? Law school dean and conference administrator. He began in the Allegheny West Conference and then traveled to the Southwestern California Conference, then became the director of admissions and financial aid at Oakwood College from 84 to 90, to Emory University in Atlanta, Georgia from 1990 to 1992, where he was the assistant director of financial aid for the law school, graduate school, business school, and the Candler School for of Theology. He then served at Georgetown University Law Center in Washington, D.C. from 92 to 98. And he served as the Associate Director of Financial Aid, where he managed and coordinated the award and the awarding and disbursement process of $47 million of institutional and federal financial resources to law students. University of Maryland Law School from 88 to 2000, where he served as the Director of Admissions, where he supervised the admissions, marketing, and student recruitment process for the university. University of Baltimore School of Law in Baltimore, Maryland from 2000 to 2004. Then he surrendered again to the call of God upon his life. It was at that time he became the executive pastor for administration. In 2005 through 2009, he served right here at the Emmanuel-Brinklow Seventh-day Adventist Church under the leadership of Dr. Marcellus T. Robinson. While serving at Brinklow, he concurrently served as the interim vice president for ministry at Washington Adventist University. After serving at Emmanuel-Brinklow, he assumed the pastoral duties of the Columbia Community Center of Columbia, Maryland, and took them through a renovation project from 2010 to 2022. In fact, I made several trips with our speaker to sites, several sites where they were about to purchase land and purchase property for the church, and every one of them fell through. But with faith, I mean, he actually walked around one of those properties and prayed like it was Jericho. They would go to closing dates and it fell through. But God is a God who cannot fail, and he answers prayer. So that on the 27th, 28th, the weekend of the 27th, 28th of this month, the Columbia Community Center, Seventh-day Adventist Church will be celebrating their grand opening in their new property that our speaker ushered them into and shepherded that process. Well, when you have a good thing, you got to keep a good thing going. In October 22, two servants of Emmanuel-Brinklow became officers in new positions for the Allegheny East Conference. Our former senior pastor, Dr. Robinson, became president, and our speaker tonight became the vice president for administration, the executive secretary of the Allegheny East Conference, where he serves currently. You never know what the Lord is going to do, what path and road he's going to take you. Our responsibility is simply to be surrendered and available when he calls. I take great pleasure in presenting to you and calling to this pulpit after we will have been favored with Ministry of Music, our speaker for tonight, the Vice President of Administration and Executive Secretary for the Allegheny East Conference, Elder Gary Wimbish.
When I first met my friend Duane Starling over 23 years ago, his commanding presence was immediately apparent. But soon enough, as the decades flew by, I began noticing something more. Someone who was insightful, passionate, but also had an insightful zeal and sincere love for life, but also his dedication to the mission, which is to advance the gospel through song. We all know him. He's here every Sabbath. But what you may not know is some of the things that he has done, which I just wanted to abbreviate in this introduction. His career reads like a roll call of musical legends. Having shared stages and studios with the likes of Kirk Franklin, Donnie McClurkin, B.B. and C.C. Winans, Fred Hammond, and international stars such as Michael Jackson, Dolly Parton, Michael McDonald, and several countless others. After a decade as a premier background vocalist in the industry, Duane embarked on his own solo career, recognizing the need for spiritual readiness to match his vocal skills. He emphasizes the importance of balance while striving to be more than just the ordinary singer, quote, end quote. Duane's discography includes his debut self-titled released project entitled Deeper Faith. He released this project in 2013 with a third album that is currently in the works. His talents extend way beyond singing to songwriting, but includes things like acting and also co-hosting the Magnify Him show on the 3ABN network. Notable compositions like Finally I and With This Ring, these well-known wedding songs were penned by Duane Starling. He has topped the wedding song charts utilizing these two songs and bringing his voice into the realization that his voice is a tool for God. Moving across the United States and now into Japan, Duane's voice is featured in Disney in Japan, Tokyo. So the next time you're there, you'll probably hear his voice. His music, marked by his simplicity and profound honesty, aims to inspire and empower listeners through his personal experiences and spiritual insights. Describing himself as a simple man Duan's ultimate ambition is to embody honor, faithfulness, and love as a husband and father, using his life to illuminate the world around him. Tonight he'll be singing two songs, two of his own compositions, the first being If This Is Faith, and the second accompanied by his friend Richard Smallwood, Holy Spirit. So please help me make my friend, our psalmist, and our brother in Christ, Duan Starling, feel welcomed.
Wow. I just, thank you, Donnell. I just landed a couple of hours ago from Bermuda. My wife, as you know, is from Bermuda, but we were there to funeralize her uncle. And he passed a week and a half ago, unexpectedly, went into his bedroom to watch the news, and a couple of hours later, he was gone. Now, this marks my mother-in-law's fourth sibling to pass in the last year and a half. And so I tell you that because I want you to keep our family lifted. Because when we left her today, I saw how broken she was. And I just want to keep her lifted. I want all of us to keep her lifted. You know, we get through this life by faith. We got through 60 years by faith. And as difficult as faith is sometimes, it is necessary. And what I've learned about faith is that if you can see it, if you can hear it, if you can touch it, if you can taste it, and if you can smell it, it's not faith. Because faith operates outside of our senses. So in essence, faith doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense that we can do the things that we do with the resources that we may or may not have. It doesn't make sense that we can build churches. It doesn't make sense that we can sustain our marriages. It doesn't make sense sometimes that we can have children excel in the situations that they've been brought up in. But we've come this far by faith. And we're still leaning on the everlasting arms of Jesus Christ. So this first song, I wrote this several years ago, and it's titled, If This Is Faith. Decided to hold on tight to what I believe inside. When I'm blinded with doubt and fear, and when I'm struggling to just be still, and the lesson is not quite clear, that's when I realize, if this is faith, then I'm going deeper beneath the weight of it all. And what should break me, I'll end up breaking with every step I take. If this is faith, ooh, ooh, are people that I've let go. I've given up things only you and I know. In the effort to have you close, closer than ever before. So no complaining of where you lead, 'cause the pathway is just what I need to become what you've always seen. And that's what I really, really wanna be. If this is faith, then I'm going deeper beneath the weight of it all. And what should break me, I'll end up breaking, yeah, with every step I take. If this is faith, then I'm trusting. And if it's faith, then I'm 'cause even when I can't prove it, you're constantly moving in my life, if this is faith, then I'm going deeper beneath the weight of it all. And what should break me, I'll end. This is faith, and I'm going deeper beneath the weight of it all. And what should break me, I'll end up breaking. Oh, with every step I take. With every step I take, if this is faith, then I'm going deeper beneath the weight of it all. And what should break me, I'll end up breaking. Step I take, every step I take, if this is faith.
Hallelujah. If we can see it, it's not faith. Whew. Now this next song, I did not write this. I wish I had written it, Donnell, but I did not write this song. It was written by Donnie Harper many, many years ago. And Pastor Claudia, I love what you just prayed.
because that really set up this song. We won't see the move of God until we're unified. It's just that simple. We can pray, we can proclaim, we can make declarations, but if we're not unified, how can the Holy Spirit come? It's not going to come. And so my prayer for all of us is that we are one. We are one in His Spirit. We are one in His power. We are one in His love. Holy Spirit, sweet comfort to my soul. Holy Spirit, let your joys unfold. Lord of the promised, power of the highest, Spirit of glory, voice of the Lord, breathe on me. Pentecost. So let the wind blow fresh from heaven. Let your promised power be given. Let it be given. Lord, let your promised power be given. Oh, Lord of the promise, power of the highest, Spirit of glory, voice of the the Spirit. It's a burning spirit. Yes, it is. That Holy Spirit. It's a mighty, mighty, mighty spirit. The Spirit. Breathe on me. That's what I need right now. I want you to breathe on me. Oh, breathe on me. Yes, God, yes, God, yes, God. I want you to breathe. We want you to breathe, Holy Spirit, breathe on me. All over this room, breathe, Lord. Ask God, I want you to breathe. Come on, can we worship him? Can we worship him? He will breathe. He will breathe. He will breathe. If we call on him, if we come before him with one heart and one mind, I guarantee the Lord will breathe. The Lord will breathe. Breathe.
Church, say amen. I need to collect myself here for a moment. I want to thank that sweet singer of Israel. Because that is my desire tonight, that the Lord will breathe on me. You know, the Bible says, covet the best gifts. I wish I could sing. But I don't want to wear out the patience of the saints. It is a joy to be back home here at Emmanuel-Brinklow Church. But before we begin, I want to thank your illustrious pastor, Dr. Marcus Harris, and his lovely wife, the First Lady, and to all, and I'm not going to do like Pastor Medley did last night, start calling names. But my dear wife, Cece, and two of the three of our children, Kalia and Brennan, are here this evening. Kyle is tuning in. It's good coming back home. I arrived here in 1992, August of 92. So this is home. This has a special place. But before we begin, I invite you to pray with me. Heavenly Father, I'm asking that you would simply hide me behind your cross. That you will take my mind and my thoughts. You will take my tongue and my lips and my mouth and bathe them in your word right now. For I am not here for a performance, but simply to be a vessel that has been shaped and formed and emptied by your hand. So breathe on me now, that what we read, what we share, what we hear will be activated by the Spirit of the living God. So give me freedom, Lord. You know how punctilious I am. So just move all of that out of the way and speak to us tonight is my prayer in Jesus' name. And God's people said, amen. I've entitled my message this evening, The Family of God. In 1979, Nile Rogers and Bernard Edwards wrote and produced a song that zoomed to number one on the charts. That song was entitled, We Are Family, by a group that maybe some of the younger folk might not remember, Sister Sledge. The lyrics were, we are family, I got all my sisters with me. We are family, get up everybody and sing. We are family, everyone can see we are together as we walk on by and we fly just like birds of a feather. I won't tell no lie. All of the people around us, they say, yeah, yeah. Can they be that close? Just let me state for the record, we're giving love in a family dose. I want to talk about the family from a couple of perspectives. When I reflect on the arc of my life, it is punctuated with people and places. Places that made a profound impact upon the formulation of who I would be and who I would become. Some of those places were the Emmanuel Temple Seventh-day Adventist Church in Youngstown, Ohio. The home church of Ron and Steve Vanderhorst, who I knew as a child growing up. University Seventh-day Adventist Church in Los Angeles, California. Tamron Avenue in Compton, California. The K Street Seventh-day Adventist Church in my classmate and colleague and friend, Dr. Delbert Baker. K Street, the forerunner of 16th Street Church. But then there was Emmanuel-Brinklow. As I shared with you in 1992, I left Atlanta, Georgia after doing a stint at Emory University, accepted a position, Duan, at Georgetown University Law Center in DC, and made my way here to Emmanuel-Brinklow in August of 1992. But it was here in this church, in this sanctuary, because in 1992, this sanctuary did not exist. It was here where I had my rebirth in authentic spiritual transformation. It was here at Brinklow that the Lord woke up that call to ministry that he had placed upon me and gave me another opportunity to respond to that. It was here at Emmanuel-Brinklow. But one of the things that my parents always instructed me on is that you cannot rely nor rest on your laurels. There is something quite significant of what has taken place and what continues to take place here at Emmanuel-Brinklow. But I want you to think about that in one track, but on the other track, I want you to think about and reflect on your own personal families. You see, I want us to look at what Paul tells us about the family. In the book of Ephesians, are you all still with me? In the book of Ephesians in chapter 3, And verses 14 through 17, Paul writes, "For this reason, I bow my knees to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, from whom the whole family in heaven and earth is named." I want to stop right there, because this family we are talking about has a broad and a wide composition that entails not just your bloodline, but it entails the faith line. The faith line of God's people, of God's church, from Eden lost all the way to Eden restored. But Paul lets us know that there is a family amongst the unfallen worlds that have not been tainted by sin. There are beings that the pen of inspiration says are watching with bated breath to see the unfolding of the plan of redemption. And Paul says this family is inclusive of the family of God. Now, I want you to stick with me, but if you don't, I'm going to give you my thesis, my proposition up front. You see, the family is held together when there is an awareness and acknowledgement and acceptance of the presence of God. It is God's presence that is the defining factor. It is the main ingredient that holds us together as a family, as well as the family of God. When I see churches that are discombobulated, if and when there is relational breakdown, where there is spiritual neurosis, it calls into question, is God's presence there? Do we have a full acceptance and an acknowledgement and an awareness of this presence? Well, I'm basing this on the fact that the family of God actually began in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve, even before the first marriage. It is when God made Adam and then took him, Pastor, to survey all of the creation that had been made and gave him the ability and the opportunity to name the animals, to look at all of the creation. There was the presence of God. There was the barrier that sin had erected was not there, because there was no sin. We know the story of Genesis chapter 3 of the fall. Adam and Eve have taken the word of the enemy. They have taken the fruit, Jason. And now the robe of light, that robe of righteousness, has dissipated. And they hear the voice of God, according to Genesis chapter 3, walking in the cool of the evening through the garden. And God is calling out, "Adam, Eve, where are you?" Adam responds, "We're here in the garden. We were hiding because we were naked." Well, who told you you were naked, Adam? I want you to see this now. You see, it is the presence of God that holds families together. But even when families fall on hard times, God is still there going in search of them. That's why for families that have experienced divorce, that have experienced disharmony, disequilibrium, all is not lost, because God goes in search of them. It is his divine presence. But there's something else that God has for us to understand in this message. You see, families are at the center. They're at the crux of this cosmic conflict. Stay with me now. There is this cosmic conflict between the forces of darkness and the Prince of Light. We know from our Bible, from Revelation chapter 12 and verses 7 through 10, that there was war in heaven, and Satan, the dragon, and his angels fought against Michael, the archangel, Jesus Christ, and he got his hips kicked. He was expelled out of heaven. And he came down to this earth. And he has now wreaked havoc. The whole creation is groaning. We look at our own political situation in this country right now. We see the disharmony, the disequilibrium. We see the struggles that our families are experiencing. It used to be that we would tell some of our children, well, some of us would tell our children, you might want to grow up to be the president of the United States. But that's when we had men, maybe a few of them, who were worthy of imitation. But do we dare say that today? There is this cosmic conflict. You see, Satan has declared war on the family, and we need to understand that if we are going to survive, we must resurrect an understanding of the acceptance of God's presence. You see, I was taught that when you have to preach a sermon or when you get ready to run a revival, that's when you take a fast from sweets and a fast from TV and do all these things so that you can zero in. See, only the old-time preachers know what I'm talking about now. But we, Pastor Harris, we would go on a fast of all of these different things so that we could be in tune with the Spirit. And I understand that logic. I understand that theory. But I feel that that created a false dichotomy. This dichotomy between what is sacred and what is secular. And I get it. I understand it. But what I'm getting at is that when we understand the presence of God, there is no time. There is no time when I am at liberty to take a rain check from God. Because my Bible tells me, Jason, that in Jeremiah, it's either chapter 40 or 42, he says, the Lord our God, he sits on top of the circle of the earth. And he views all men as if they are grasshoppers. David says he sits high and he sees every man, every woman, and everything that they do. I want you to understand something, that in creation, in the Garden of Eden, there was no downtime when Adam could just be free from the presence of God. He was constantly there. There is something that takes place that is dynamic, that is incarnational, that helps us to develop intimacy with Jesus Christ. And so here we see that the Lord God Almighty is trying to get us to understand that in this dynamic of being in a family, he becomes critical. He becomes crucial in our daily walk with him, this presence of God. Well, in Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3, the Lord tells Abraham, you know, Abraham, I need you to leave your father's house. I need you to leave all of your relatives. And I need you to go to a land that I'm going to tell you later on. But you need to leave your home. Now, Sister Pearl, I used to be troubled by this. What is the application for me and for you? You see, sometimes we have to leave the familiar. Sometimes we have to leave certain relationships. Sometimes we have to abandon certain mindsets. Sometimes we have to let go of certain environments so that God can remove us and getting us in a place where he can zero in on this incarnational relationship that we have with him. And what do I mean by that? Just like Jesus was part human and part divine, and this incarnational relationship, he is saying what Ezekiel says, let me take your heart of flesh, your heart of stone, pardon me, and I will now give you a heart of flesh. I'm going to take that spirit that is in you, that vindictive and retaliatory spirit, that evil spirit, that slanderous spirit, and I'm going to put my sweet Holy Ghost in you. So therefore we end up, Doreen, working like it all depends on us, but praying like it all depends on Jesus. I'm talking about the family of God. And he tells Abram in chapter 12 of Genesis, verses 1 through 3, the Lord had said to Abram, leave your native country, your relatives, and your father's family, and go to the land that I will show you. I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you and make you famous, and you will be a blessing to others. Now, I don't have my theology mixed up here. I know that God was giving Abram a very specific message here. But there is a message and a lesson of applicability, of transferability that applies to us. When God calls us out of the miry mud pool of sin and he places a new heart and a new spirit in us, we then become a blessing to others. And when every family that is comprised or that comprises the Emmanuel-Brinklow Seventh-day Adventist Church or whatever church you belong to, when every family is saying, number one, I understand that God's presence is with me no matter where I go, no matter where I am, and we all come together, there is this collective power. It is the same thing that you see in the book of Acts at that early church. They came together in fellowship. They came together to break bread. They came together to study the word of God. They came together to hear the word of God, and they came together to do service. When that happens, it is the preparation for the downpouring, the outpouring, the baptism of God's Holy Spirit. So here is Abram, who now becomes Abraham. But there is something that is quite interesting when you read through the Pentateuch. In the book of Genesis, we see the story of these four great prophets of Abram, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph. And then as we get into the book of Exodus and Leviticus and Numbers and Deuteronomy, we have the story of Moses. But I want to zero in on the book of Numbers where Moses is leading the people of God. There are a number of times, and I won't take the time to read all these different passages that I have in my notes, but it is where the presence of God was manifested. In Numbers chapter 7 and verse 89, Moses writes that every time God was ready to speak to Moses, guess where he did it? Numbers 7, 89 says that he went to the door of the tabernacle. It was at the tabernacle that when God spoke to Moses, the glorious presence of God would settle down over that sanctuary. Well, we know for certain that in the most holy place, there was the Ark of the Covenant. And above the Ark of the Covenant was the mercy seat. And both ends of the mercy seat were two cherubims with their wings outspread, covering it. And the holy Shekinah glory of God would show up there and would manifest himself. Every time God wanted to say something to Moses, Numbers 7:89 says he would go there and God would speak to him. Every journey that they made, every time they made a move, every time they had to break camp, it was when the pillar of cloud, I want y'all to get this, they could see a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. The presence of God, Korah, Dathan, and Abiram, who decided that they knew better than Moses and Aaron. Who Korah was a Levite. Do you understand where Korah actually lived in the setup of the sanctuary? He lived with his crew on the south side of the tabernacle, the Kohites. Korah was part of the crew that actually carried the sacred furniture. You know, they had 12 wagons. And the 12 wagons were delivered to the
12 tribes, and they would carry the post and the pillars and the curtains and the goat skins. But it was Korah and his crew where they could not put the sacred ark on a wagon, but they had to carry it with the poles that was covered on their shoulders. In other words, Korah had a high position of responsibility, but somehow the spirit of the enemy got in him and he got jealous and filled up with himself because he had some degrees or because of his pedigree. And so therefore he began to criticize Moses and Aaron. In fact, the Bible says, you know, Moses and Aaron, what makes y'all think you so special? You know, the Lord speaks through us just like he speaks through you. The Word of God says, talking about the family, the Word of God declares, Moses went and cried out to the Lord, and the Lord said, enough of this nonsense. Tell them to get 250 censers, put some incense on it, and then we're going to come before the Lord and we're going to find out who is on the Lord's side. Who is God using? They came and they met there outside of the tabernacle. Give me a moment. I want to tell you this story. Moses declares, if you happen to die a natural death, then you know beyond a shadow of a doubt, God has not spoken through me. But if indeed something happens and this earth opens up and swallows you, then you know beyond a shadow of a doubt that God is not with you and he is with me. And in the original Hebrew, it is the present active indicative tense. It happened immediately that earth opened up. Now, here's the thing. They saw the presence of God. In Numbers 16, in verses 3 and 20, it says that the presence of God hovered over them, Delbert. The presence of God. So what does this tell me? Why is this so relevant for us today? Because you can see God moving, but if you don't know him, if you have not accepted him, if you have not acknowledged him, then you will not be able to recognize or appreciate what God has done and what God is doing, but more importantly, what God can and will do for you in the future. There are other incidents where we see God's glorious presence hovering down over his people trying to get their attention. Come on, my musicians. But there is something else that this presence of God will do. You see, God's presence introduces us to a process where we are trying to pursue him. When I am pursuing God, I'm moving into a realm of being intimate with him. Now, this intimacy then enables me to live with integrity. And when I live in intimacy with Jesus, there is a corresponding integrity that takes place, which then enables me to have influence. Word of God says, if y'all say there is a fountain, Word of God says that John the Baptist as well as Jesus grew in favor with men and with God. That's all I've ever wanted. To be used by him. But to first have a real, authentic, intimate relationship with Jesus Christ, who is not only my Savior, but who is my Lord. You know what that means? That means I give him full surrender. It took me a long time to learn that lesson. Learned it right here. I used to sit back in that pew right where my daughter and my wife and my son are sitting right now. I can remember a particular Sabbath. The choir was up here when we had chairs. Rick Phillips was directing the choir. Nolette was singing a song from Brooklyn Tap. And I can remember the Spirit of God nudging me. When are you going to come? Full surrender, where I experience his presence. Does that mean I'm walking with a Bible under my arm every day? No. Does it mean you won't lose your temper? No. But there is an awareness, because this intimacy doesn't mean that you're going to be completely ethical all the time. The integrity means that there now is a collaboration. There is now cohesion. There is now adhesion, where the inner man, where the inner spirit is now connected spiritually, physically, existentially. Use whatever adjective you want to use. There is a connectivity, and there is a divine human transaction that takes place where I am changed into his likeness. Sometimes it's by leaps and bounds. Sometimes there are periods of drought. Sometimes there is exponential and explosive growth. But there is a daily walk and a daily connection, because I am becoming intimate with him. Here's a news flash. I used to think, man, who in the world wants to live like that? And then I thought about what heaven is going to be like. I'm gonna sit down now. I started thinking about what heaven's going to be like. There's a song that says every day will be like Sunday. Every day is going to be like Sabbath. Do you think that when we get to heaven, we're going to want to have a day off from Jesus? You're going to think that I can only be holy on Sabbath, but on Monday and Tuesday, I can kind of let my hair down. I can have a break. Pen of Inspiration says that we will spend the ceaseless ages of eternity studying the cross. Eye hath not seen, ear hath not heard, neither has entered into the hearts of man the things that God has prepared for us. So my question to you is, if you're getting tired, or you think being in God's presence is too much for you here to down here right now, what in the world are you going to do if you got to heaven? This is why we are here. I'm at the stage in my life now where I just want to do his will. I want to enjoy my family. I want to enjoy my grandchildren. even playing a game of basketball. Not really. But this is the work. This is the call that Jesus has extended to the family of God. We had a saying here, Brinklow, you know. But now it is time for us to understand that we have his presence. His presence. I don't think it's accidental of my journey, and I don't know where it's going. I have no idea. And I'm not even concerned, not worried. I'm not planning nothing. I could lay my head down tonight and wake up in the morning seeing King Jesus in glory, because tomorrow is not promised. If you want to experience his presence in a deeper, more profound, more authentic way, then I invite you to stand with me. Heavenly Father, you have been so gracious and so good to us. You have blessed us through this church family for 60 years. And we give you all praise, all honor, and all glory because it is you. So tonight, as you are seated in that place of honor, next to the Father, at his right hand in the throne room, my prayer is that our offerings of praise and thanksgiving and song and prayer and the proclamation and of the greetings, that they have been received and it is a sweet savor in your nostrils. So now do for us what you did for the 120. Then what you did for the 3,000 and the 5,000 and the countless others who came to an understanding of your precious word and accepted this gospel truth. Equip us now. Place angels that excel in might and strength around the four corners of our homes, our children who might be away at school or who are now living their own lives with their own homes. Lord, place your favor. Cause your face to smile upon us. And then when you crack that eastern sky and the voice of our Savior will cry out and those who are now resting will come forth. We look forward to that grand reunion. But until then, Lord Jesus, we will keep on singing, keep on praying because of this great fountain is our prayer in Jesus' name. God's people said, amen. You may be seated.
Oh, yeah.
Just affirm the man of God one more time by putting our hands together. The family of God. Nothing like having or experiencing the presence of God on a deeper and more authentic level. And sometimes we are called to leave places and spaces that God will show us. Our responsibility is to obey him. And intimacy allows us to live with integrity. And this integrity gives us influence. I want the influence of the Lord on my life. Come on, say amen. Amen. We thank God. Yasmin Julian is watching. Donna Holt, Anita Anderson, Ernest Bryan, and so many others are watching tonight. Thank you for joining us virtually. We want you to be reminded that tomorrow evening at 6 p.m., what time did I say, everybody? 6 p.m., there is a light meal. And at 6:30, we're going to dismiss you so that you don't go to your car, but you come up to the sanctuary. Come on, say amen. It'll be a shame to come here for 30 minutes to eat and go home. Come on up here and get the rest of the food. Can I get a witness? Do me a favor and invite someone else to join you in person. Can we get some folk like that? At least invite them. Invite them, send them a text, call them, encourage them to be with us. And then tomorrow night, Paul Anderson will be our speaker, Dr. Paul Anderson, along with Psalmist Moret Brown Clark. As the praise team comes to sing just a little bit of our theme song as we look to the Lord to be dismissed, won't you stand to your feet as we ask God's blessings to be with us as we travel to our safe places. Father, you spoke to us tonight, reminded us about the family of God. We are indeed the family of God. Help us to act like it. Help us to act like it tonight. And we'll give you praise for what you're going to do. Take us home safely. Give us a good night's rest. And bring us back on tomorrow night. Help us to invite and encourage someone else to be with us in this revival. For it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Come on, say amen again. Amen. Fist pound somebody beside you. Say, I'll see you tomorrow night. See you tomorrow night.
Sound of revival deep in the hearts of your people. Send it now. We want it. We want it now. I hear the sound of revival deep in the hearts of your people. Send it now. We need it. We need it now. Release your glory. Release your glory.